A very good afternoon to all of you and a very warm welcome to all the participants, including our speaker for the day, Dr. Nachappa sir. I extend my heartiest welcome also to Dinesh sir, our vertical head, and thank you so much for organizing this 14-day long extensive FDP program for all of us at Jain Deemed to be University. I think the pace has been very rightly set yesterday with Dr. Shraddha ma'am's lecture or her presentation on meta competencies. And we really enjoyed the day. I don't think any of my faculty would disagree on the fact that yesterday we were all so very enthusiastic and we really enjoyed the session, and the 2 hours simply just passed by and we never really came to know how it went. Very interesting. And I'm hoping that the entire FDP for the 14 days will also be similarly set. Now, today I would like to introduce Dr. Nachappa sir, head for the School of CS and IT at Jain Deemed to be University. Now, I don't think Nachappa sir really requires a special or a different introduction, because we have been interacting and coordinating with him on a day-to-day basis. I mean, I think I've never missed a single day where I haven't called Nachappa sir for any query or any clarification. Be it a Sunday or a Monday, be it morning 6 o'clock or the evening 9 o'clock, he's always been available, and he's never shown any sign of irritation or something that he's always been very, very approachable, and something which I think has been one of the very driving force for he's been one of the very driving force for coordinating and controlling the entire department of the School of CS and IT, of course, animation within that. Today, because of this very approachable personality, we are all very happy to have you also here today, sir, for today's day two, which is on understanding higher education system. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you, madam. So thank you for the warm words that you have used to describe me. So makes me feel very happy to be among a group of talented people as such. Okay. So makes me feel talented sometimes. Okay. So that is the proudness as such. As a department, as you know, okay, so you are a department of today as such. So I have been telling this to my friends, okay, all the while as such. So you are the department of the future. So you will be making a mark as such. And naturally, the students require you. Okay? So that is the level to which we place you as such. And I'm very happy to be part of this and to share some information here as such. Now, the pace has been set yesterday with Shraddha madam, and you have understood probably with the session that you have had on meta competencies, how additional skills are required, okay, for us to survive as such. Today, we will be looking at understanding higher education system. So it is more of a knowledge sharing session that we will be having. And like I said, I'm very happy to be part of you. So a lot of you are known colleagues to me, so who have been in the campus, okay, interacting with me daily, okay? So including personal things as such. So we have been discussing all those things. Some of you are new to the system, so you have probably not seen me physically as such, but I have been interacting with you through the sessions we have been having or meetings that we have been having as such. And of course, we have some special members who are part of the HO who are also my friends. Okay. So Ajay is there, Rufus is there. Okay. So it is very nice for me to, okay, interact with you and probably share this session as such. So like I said, it will be more of a knowledge sharing session. So let me start by sharing the screen.
I hope I am audible to all of you.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, and you can see the screen.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Very good. Okay. So the topic that I have here is understanding higher education. Okay. Now, why this is important is especially when you go to the classroom, the children who are sitting in front of us are part of this environment. Okay. So what we call as higher education. So I would want to say for you to understand this, okay, and then slowly we will take it forward. So first I will be describing what is higher education, okay, what are the needs of higher education, how it is important for us, and I will also give you a brief information related to the Indian scenario as such, okay, in terms of, okay, numbers as such. Then we will have a brief understanding of the global perspective. So there I would again divide it into two aspects as such. So one aspect will be dealing with how global education is important. And second aspect, I will be dealing with outcome-based education, which is again, okay, something which has been introduced across the world and is important for us. And we have been part of a few workshops and seminars that has been happening recently. Now, as you know, when we talk of higher education, so what is this? Okay, education, normally we divide it into three types as such. One, what we call as primary education. So the first 7 years of your education deals with primary education. That probably sets the tone for you of what you want to do in life, or sets the foundation for you as such. Then we have secondary education, which represents the next 5 years of your studies. So, and after that, okay, so we come to higher education. So higher education, as you know, is also called as tertiary education, and it deals or results in an academic degree at the end of that. And of course, it is also continuous. So whatever you learn in higher education, so continues throughout your life. So that is why one of the outcomes is lifelong learning as such. Now, as I'm taking this session, of course, I'm presenting something. Like I said, it is knowledge sharing as such. So with each slide, I would want your, say, reactions. So I'd want you to comment, probably ask questions. Okay, if I'm asking something, you can even, okay, unmute and give me your answers. Okay, so we want that interaction to happen. Otherwise, you know, it's an afternoon session and after lunch. So it might be a little sleepy as such. So we don't want you to go into that state. So I would want that interaction to happen. So let us start. Okay. What is the importance of higher education today? Okay. So if you look at education during, say, for example, my times. So at that stage, probably you'd realize that education itself was not a very important aspect of our lives as such. So probably parents did not think so much about education. For example, say my parents probably did not bother to even think, say, which is the best schools that are available that I could be sent. The only probably important thing was which was the nearest school that was available through which you could be sent. Okay. And they probably did not bother much about, okay, what I should become in future. They left it to us saying that, okay, so it is your decision. So you do whatever you want. Okay. So that sort of thing as such. But so today, if you look at education, probably you would realize that it plays a more significant role in all aspects of our life, okay? Especially now, okay? So now you are at a stage probably where you have children or will have children, and you'd probably realize that, okay, so with children, you already start planning about their life as such, okay? So where, which school they have, you want to send them. And there is a lot of competition that is involved, okay? There also as such, you would probably want them to go to one of the best institutions as such, get the best possible education. And you have a plan, okay? So my child should become this or that as such. So education today plays a very important role as such. And especially with higher education, we know that higher education increases our opportunities. This is very much true. Okay, so probably you would have realized this more as such. Okay, a lot of you have recently joined our institution as such, and you have joined here, okay, mainly because of your education. And this has probably given you the opportunity as such. You would realize that, okay, so your opportunity probably is global today. Okay, so it is not confined to a small area, okay, or small geographical area or anything as such. And these opportunities naturally lead to a lot of improvement in the quality of your life. Slowly, if you look at your lifestyle, okay, over a period of time, you would realize that a lot of things have got added into your system. Even if it is your house, you would probably see that, okay, so the quality has improved. Okay, so even in terms of the way you're dressing, probably the way you are say interacting, the way places you go, okay, all these things, you would see that it has improved the quality of your life. And like I already said, okay, so today parents give a lot of importance to education. So it is very important, okay, for them. Okay, and naturally, okay, so they have an idea, okay, they see a lot of opportunities that are there. Okay, for example, a lot of people who are in the computer industry would want their children to study, okay, data science or probably artificial intelligence or probably machine learning, because they feel that is the trend of today as such. And in a field like USK, you can see that, okay, parents would want children to learn new technologies as such, so that, okay, so that can be incorporated. And finally, you will realize that it is all related to earning something as such. Okay, so and earning naturally leads to, okay, better quality of life that is there. What is your opinion? Okay, so do you feel that higher education does play a role in our life, or it is just a continuation of, okay, you have some money, so you continue your education and then go forward? Do you think it is like that? Anybody would want to respond?
Yes, sir. No, sir. I don't think that it is only for the sake of doing a degree or a certification. I think it is very much required in terms of our professional growth. So if we all have taken up a profession of teaching or learning, I think it all depends on that it is not only a part of, like, you know, when we are in any other field, like maybe a doctor or an engineer or anything, we're just working. But as teachers, there is always so much open for us to learn, to give to our students, that for us also, learning does not end.
So finally, do you think that there is a need for professional growth?
Of course, sir.
So you think so? Okay. Yes. Okay. So that is what probably we are looking at here as such. So why it is important for us to have professional growth? Why it is important for us to look into higher education? So I'm looking at one part of this as such. And of course, yesterday's session would have said that additionally, you require more skills also. We will be looking at that slightly later as such. Okay. So when I look at, say, for example, why higher education is important, I have some factors that I have identified, okay, economic factors, health, probably civic involvement, all these things as such. So let us briefly look into each one of them and try to understand them as such, okay. So what is this economic factor? Okay, so economic factor, okay, naturally says that, okay, with higher education, you earn money. So that much we know, okay? And probably there is no better person than you yourself to understand this as such, okay? So statistics say that, okay? So the, more higher education that you have, the more skills that you have added to your personality, so that leads to a better opportunity. And that opportunity naturally leads to better earnings, and naturally, okay, it lowers the probability of unemployment. Okay, so that much is so. So economic condition naturally is important. Okay, now why I'm trying to tell these things is again because when you go to a class, you should understand that the boy sitting in front of you, okay, the child sitting in front of you has come there because one day he wants to achieve all these things. Okay. And we, okay, like Rini madam said, okay, we as facilitators should be probably supporting him in that process as such. Unlike, for example, the days when we were studying. So the when we were studying, the more important factor was only completing the syllabus. So understand that. So I would go to a class, take up a topic. I have done that. Okay. Immaterial of bothering whether the student has actually understood that. Okay. So whether it is useful for him, not useful for him, no. Okay. So today it is not like that. That is where okay, slowly we will be trying to understand about outcome-based education also. So economic factor is very important. Health, again, okay. Health is a very, 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 very important factor now. And probably we have realized this more because of the present situation that is existing as okay. A good, say, job naturally leads to good economic condition, and good economic condition reduces the stress in your life. Okay. So when stress is reduced, you know that you lead a healthy life. Okay. So probably diseases like BP and diabetes would come to you at a much later stage as such. Otherwise, you would probably realize where okay, youngsters, okay, very, okay, young people are getting this as such, and naturally whatever they are earning, they are spending a major part of their income okay, on health. Okay, so health naturally okay, economic condition of okay, student with higher education naturally has a better health as such, and he of course okay, has opportunities and can afford better health facilities also. Okay, I mean, I'm talking of health facilities. It might include medical facilities also and non-medical facilities also. Okay. When you talk of, for example, say an opportunity to join a club, okay, an opportunity to exercise, all this is possible because of financial security. The third factor probably which might be important is okay, civic involvement. Naturally, with good economic conditions, you would see that okay, you have an urge to give back to the society. Okay. And that comes okay, because you have already okay, earned what is required. You are financially stable. Now you feel that I can say contribute to community as a, so that is possible. So with higher education. Personal development, okay. Naturally, okay, when we talk of, say, our lives, okay, you would probably realize, if you look at your life, probably you would see that it is a repetition which is happening every day, okay. You are probably getting up at a particular time, okay, every day, probably getting up in a particular manner, okay. So after getting up, okay, you would probably look at somebody, okay, in a sequence as such. So your life that you're leading is more structured as such. Okay. Probably you are even religiously oriented because of that also as such. So you'd see that. Okay. So there is a stronger sense of responsibility in terms of okay, what we are doing. And one of the reasons may be because okay, people are observing us. It might be our own children. Okay. You would probably have say, a life to lead, okay, a life to probably say show to your children so that they can follow those okay, good features of your life as a, so that becomes very important, and that naturally again happens because of okay, good education. Okay, so you understand the importance as a, and most important, remember, with education you learn to communicate. Okay, and you learn to communicate verbally in a proper manner. So this is very important. Okay. So if you look at, for example, somebody without education, the way he is communicating, especially if it is say colloquial language that you're using, the type of words that they might be using, even though he might not say mean any offense to the other person, you'd probably realize that okay, some words you would probably never use in your life. Okay. So that is important. And with education, you have realized that okay, so I have to avoid these words. Okay, I can communicate like this. Okay, and you probably, this becomes more important, especially when you are taking a class. Okay, So you have a lot of students. Okay? Students tend to remember they have come from the school level, from secondary education, slowly they have come here. So that childish behavior would not have completely gone out of their system. And they tend to irritate you. Okay? And at that stage, probably it is your education which tells you what type of words you have to use, okay, and how to control yourselves. All this might happen there as such. Realization of passion may be one more factor that is possible with education. What are the passions that are available? Okay, you would probably, okay, again, try, say, may understand it, okay, better because of the, say, factors that are available today, because of, okay, the options that are available today as such. And probably you might want to enjoy those passions as such. Okay, for example, you want to do gardening. Okay. So if you take a few years back, you'd probably realize that the passion would come only when probably you know the system, how to garden, what are the things that are necessary, so what are the instruments that are required, what is the space that is required, how you can organize that. So all this is possible with naturally one opportunities, and second one with education as such. So those are some of the things that get added as such. And like I already said, with education comes a greater sense of discipline. Okay, so this is very important, especially how you treat people. So this is very important. When you come to campus, you'd realize that there are a lot of people who are supporting your work as such. Okay. So attenders are there, clerical staff are there, non-teaching staff are there, many are there as such. So how to interact with them? Okay. So all that discipline probably would come with education as such. Okay. So you treat people in a better manner when you are more educated as such. And of course, with each competency that gets added to your life, you have that sense of accomplishment. Okay. You are proud of what you have done. Okay, and you want others to understand that. It's like, for example, as if you have completed an assignment or you have completed a project, you have completed an art, a drawing, something like that. These are some of the factors which I have identified are important for, are important and come along with higher education as well. Anybody would want to comment on this? Somebody would want to add something to this?
Yes, sir. Actually, whatever you said just now, it's everything is correct. But one more thing I wanted to add, like for education, normally the education will teach us like what is right and wrong, maybe yes. how to live our life with a perfect manner. So maybe all this, including along with this rules, generally why we are following that. Prayer time or interval and lunch time. So everything like it is, we need to follow some certain kind of rule. So education is, it is taking very big part to control, to assign rules for all the people.
Very good. Okay, so it's exactly right, sir. Okay, so that is what probably I meant when I said a greater sense of discipline also as such. But if you are some of the youngsters who are part of this group today probably might to a certain extent disagree as such. For them, life is not rules. Okay, understand that. Especially for example, for you, getting up early is very important. Okay, for them, getting up early is a punishment. Okay, so these types of rules probably gets added on with age and probably gets more added on with family also. Okay, so you'll probably realize those things are also important. And of course, like you have said, it is part of the discipline that is required and is compulsory as such. Very good, sir. Thank you, sir. Okay. Naturally, with higher education, so developing ourselves is important, no doubt about that. Okay, some additional things that might happen, you'd realize that higher education creates more opportunities for us. When I say opportunity, it probably means even job also. Okay? So if you just try to analyze, for example, somebody who has had only primary education, what type of job would he probably get? Any idea?
Can I talk to you, sir, regarding this matter?
Yes. See, I told you it's an interactive session. Yeah, okay? There's no limitation as such, so we can always say valuable suggestions are very important. Very good.
Yeah, sir. For primary education, candidates can get a job like a primary teacher, first priority, second priority.
Primary education is first 7 years of your life. So probably up to seventh standard. Okay. So somebody who has had only education of second standard, fourth standard, fifth standard, sixth standard. Okay. What type of job? I don't think primary teacher would be possible.
The primary teacher can be possible, sir. It would be minimum matriculation, I think, sir.
No, primary teacher degree. Degree is compulsory.
Yes.
Nowadays, B.Ed. degree also
compulsory.
Yes. B.Ed. is compulsory.
Sir, few state governments, sir, if you talk about another state, they are taking only 10th pass, and after that they are taking primary TET exams, which you will qualify. After that, they will be eligible for the primary teacher, sir.
Yes. 10th class, no. Now I think if you look at guidelines that have come, so a degree is compulsory and B.Ed. is again compulsory requirement of a primary teacher. So when we talk of primary education, probably we are talking of lower education as such. Somebody who has just introduced as such. Clerical also would be difficult. Probably it would be unstructured jobs which are available.
Like something like office boy types of jobs.
Yeah, something like office boy, attenders. Okay? So if you look at our environment as such, outside probably you would see, you would probably realize somebody who's even at lower levels of jobs that are there. So those are the types of jobs. Probably they have got into those jobs because of not having education as such. Secondary education, probably maybe clerical jobs that might be possible as such. A little secondary education, somebody who's maintaining small accounts, so something like that. Okay. So you realize that with more and more education, and especially when you come to higher education, so opportunities are more. Okay. Why I'm trying to stress on this is, this is probably one of the points we will have to stress on when we are in the class. Okay, so you will have to tell him. Okay, for example, what you are teaching in the class is probably one part of education as such. And like you have learned in yesterday's session, the more competency which gets added to him, more skills which get added to him along with the classes that you are taking, provides him with more opportunities. And naturally, more opportunity leads to better economic conditions and better everything that we have learned. So that is one of the things that we should understand. Okay. And like I said, so if you want to stay competitive, naturally, one, higher education is important. Okay. Along with that, skills have to be added. Okay. Today it is completely different. Understand that. Okay? For example, the need of a teacher or the work of a teacher is not just coming to a class and taking the class as such. Okay? You are probably a mentor also. Okay? So that means you require the skill of counseling students. Mm-hmm. Okay? So that is important. You are sometimes a policeman also. Okay, so you understand, probably a lot of you have not been in campus. And if you just try to understand the interactions that I have, Rini madam said she is interacting with me on a daily basis. And a lot of our interaction is only most of the time is related to these things. Those situations which arise, and how to control them, how to be strict, so all these things assess. So competency has to be added, and that comes only with education. That is important. Okay. And of course, with higher education, you learn a lot of new skills. Okay. So that are there. What are the skills that we might be learning? Some of them I have highlighted here. So one is the ability to think. Okay. Problem solving, as we call that in computer language. So we call that as problem solving. And a problem can be solved only when you have understood the problem. understand them. Okay, and to understand that problem, naturally it requires a different perspective. Okay, so and to some extent, I would say that okay, to a large extent, education is very, very important. Okay, for example, now okay, so if somebody asks me to make coffee or tea, okay, unless I know what is coffee or what is tea, I will not be able to okay, get into that process at all. So that thinking ability, okay, so makes us that comes as part of us mainly because of education. And once you are able to think, you are able to analyze. Okay, analyze is okay, breaking down a problem into smaller manageable parts. Okay, for example, like I said, if it is the process of making tea. Okay, so then what are the steps that I have to follow to make? Okay, so that I'm able to analyze. Okay, next, okay, I would be able to analyze what would be the inputs that are required to make tea. Okay, for example, it might be okay, say water, it might be milk, it might be powder, it might be sugar, and so on like that. Okay, so the ability to analyze. Okay, so that ability to think. Okay, becomes part of our system. Okay, so naturally. With education. Okay. Now here I'm giving you very vague examples. Understand this. Mm-hmm. Now this becomes much more important when you are in the class. Okay, because when you are interacting with students, you'd probably realize that they come out with okay, different types of questions to you. And at that stage, you have to be able to put across okay, the solution in a more structured manner. And you probably have to generate solutions immediately. And okay, again, you can see that the say ability to explore new ideas, okay, the ability to ask questions, okay, the type of questions that you ask to the student, okay, all this becomes okay, a part of our culture, okay, with higher education. Okay, and probably you realize that, okay, so if you observe, say your students, you'd realize that slowly, okay, from first semester to second semester to third semester, slowly these things are added. Okay, that is why you'd probably realize that when they come to fourth or fifth or sixth semester, they are more closer to you, okay, because they are now on okay, the frequency at which you are working as such. So you are able to interact, okay, you are able to okay, communicate with them in a much better manner. Okay, so this is some information related to higher education as well. So let us look at some data related to higher education in India as such. Okay, what is the state of higher education? Okay, somewhere okay, the rough statement that is said is it is somewhere between good and bad. We don't say higher education is very good or it is very bad. Some numbers I am projecting here. I would not authenticate the numbers as such. I have taken it from various sources. So I have not cross verified as such. So roughly we say we have around 875 universities and around 52,627 colleges. Okay, so 8,17,000 professors. Okay, and over 8 crores students enrolled in higher education. If you look at this numbers, probably when you look at 8 crore students enrolled, I just read a statement somewhere. It says that it is more than the population of 40 countries in the world. Okay, so that is the number. Okay, staggering numbers that we have as such. Okay, and the growth of these colleges are increasing drastically, exponentially every year that is happening as such. And if you look at these students, you probably realize around 14 crore students have applied and around 8 crore students have been enrolled as such. So that means there is again a huge gap as such. You have not been able to enroll a huge number of students into the system. Okay. And for post graduation, we have approximately around 2 crore students who are enrolled. Okay, for research, we have around 13 lakh people in that. Okay, diploma, we have around 17 lakh students as part of this. Okay, so this is the situation in India. That means the numbers are very, very high. Okay, and in terms of the world, status in higher education. We are probably the third as such. Okay, the highest is United States, next comes China, and probably we are the third in terms of numbers, okay, in terms of the number of students, number of universities, all these things as such. So that is the status. Let us look at some of the say financial implications that are there. Okay, you'd probably realize that case. Okay, so around 65,000 crores are spent. Okay, so and this is again increasing. Okay, so the government has been good enough to spend little more than what they had done last year, 17% more than that. Okay, and higher education constitutes about 16,000 crores. Okay, which is again a 20% high. Okay, similarly. Okay, so we have around okay. Say 2,400 crores spent for IITs, 1,300 crores for NITs. Okay, so all these things. So these are some of the financial spendings that is there as such. Okay, so again, you can imagine it's a big business that is there. Okay, I would not call it as business as such because these are government expenditures that we are looking at as such. Now, what are the issues that we are facing with higher education, especially in India today? So one of the main issues that we are facing is naturally the teaching quality. Okay, you'd probably realize okay, in certain cities it is good, okay, no doubt as such, or even certain states probably you'd realize gives a lot of importance to education and to higher education, and naturally they look into the quality of the teachers that are there. But some of, if you just go through YouTube, you'd probably realize okay, a lot of teachers okay, probably do not have knowledge of what they are teaching. Okay, so that is the situation. Okay, I recently saw a video where an English teacher was teaching somewhere in UP as such. Okay, and was not able to answer simple questions, simple words, and so on as such. Now, naturally, we cannot blame the system completely as such. So probably there's a lot of issues that have to be sorted out as such. Okay, so that is there. So now here, okay, understand this. Okay, I'm not blaming the system as such. So probably these are the issues, and probably we can say pitch in here and provide some probably suggestions, some help somewhere. Okay, so to improve the system as much as possible. Financing is another factor, of course. Okay, so if you look at the number of universities that we have, 875 universities, out of that probably the central and state universities are very less. Okay, almost around 80% of the universities that we have are private universities. Okay, not even deemed universities, private universities. That means funded by okay, say private people as such, funded by businessmen, and to a large extent funded by politicians as such. So that is the system that we are having. Of course, government is trying to do as much as possible. They have much greater issues to solve as such. The third factor that we have, third problem issue is privatization. Privatization is very important, no doubt about that. Okay, but unless we put in a procedure, standard procedure, unless we put in some rules and regulations and guidelines, privatization might lead to businesses. Okay, so a lot of private players might consider this as some disturbance is there. Okay, yeah, so a lot of private players might take this opportunity to probably earn money for themselves rather than looking at say helping children in terms of their creativity, in terms of their imagination, skills, everything. Okay, and so on as such. Okay, of course. Okay, so I would not want to connect too much on the quota system. There are multiple opinions on this case. So, one section feels that it is a requirement. Okay, so one section feels that we have been into this for a very long time, and slowly we have to move forward as such. So that is also one of the factors which are probably affecting maybe the way we are identifying talent, merit, and all those things as such. But the major factor that is affecting today's system is the political factor. Okay, so politicians are part of the governing bodies of many of them, and naturally they have their agenda and they would want to run the institutions based on their agenda as such. Okay, and of course, so moral issues are there. If you look at the younger generation, like I said, we face this situation every day as such. Probably if you look at my generation of teachers, you probably realize that time is a very important factor for us. Coming on time, going to the class on time. So these are important issues. And a lot of your coordinators would have seen this, especially when we are having exam duties as such. So the younger generations is not at all bothered. They feel that the exam timing should be adjusted according to their convenience. It is not that they have to come according to the exams timings, but it can be adjusted according to their this. What are the challenges that we are facing? One is the gap in supply and demand. If you look at the gross enrollment ratio in India, it is only 19%. And it is almost 6% less than the world average. World average includes a lot of underdeveloped countries and so on as such. And it is 50% lesser than good countries like Australia and US. So that is one of the major problems that we have. And like I said, so a lot of private institutions have come in. And naturally, these institutions have not come in with the purpose of serving the society or serving the students as such. Their main purpose has naturally been to make money as And one of the challenges that we have is the skill. Like you have seen, if you have attended the workshop conducted by our vice chancellor, so he has given a lot of importance to project-based learning. Now the word project should not be misunderstood. So Rini Madam was there in the presentation that we gave to the Vice Chancellor as such. There when he said project basically he means is an activity. So an activity which the student should perform so that he understands the subject that you have taught him through that activity as such. So a skill that has to be picked up by the student as such. So that is a requirement. Of course, so when you look at higher education, there is no strategy that we have on how to improve this. So if you want to improve the gross enrollment ratio, how to improve that? Some states have done that. For example, Bihar introduced the concept of providing cycles to girl students so that they enroll into schools and attend schools. Karnataka has a system of midday meals that are there so that again students stay back in school. At least they will come to school for that and so on like this. Likewise, when we look at higher education, we do not have a proper strategy there as such. So how to keep students there, how to keep them interested, how to have students from other countries to come and so on like that. So that is one thing that is required. And of course, if you just have listened to Dinesh sir yesterday, he was talking of we are more of a service industry. So our job is just to understand the requirement of the industry and provide them with people for working on that job as such. So we have not gone into a situation where we become providers as such. So that is not possible. We are just meeting to the requirements of other people as such. That is one part of that. Naturally, now with higher education, and probably if you look at the early 1990s onwards, we have had this concept of outcome-based education which has been introduced. And the need for outcome-based educations was probably to make our graduates competitive and on par with people who are studying in the other part of this world as such. So globally, they should be acceptable. Globally, they should be able to, whatever you are teaching here should be accepted there and so on as such. So that is where a global perspective has come. Now in the first part, I am dealing with more of in sending, say, for example, interaction as such, students coming from outside to our universities and our students going there, and what is the say issues that they are facing as such. And in the second part, we will look at the quality part of that. That is where we will look at outcome-based education as such. Okay, and what does global education involve? Naturally, it involves the study of problems, okay, cut across national boundaries. Okay, national and international boundaries also as such. Probably when you look at students who are there in our campus, you would realize that a lot of them are from North India. Okay, a lot of our students are from say even southern part of India, Kerala for example as such. And there is a lot of cultural difference there between them and between us. Okay, so even in the way they dress, the mannerism that they have and so on as such. And sometimes probably we might feel that it is arrogance. Okay, in reality it might not be that as such. Okay, in reality it is only that, okay, he has been, okay, he has been in that environment and he has come up in that environment, and because of that he is exhibiting those behaviors as such. So it becomes important for us to understand these things. Okay, so the cultural boundaries, the environmental boundaries, okay, the economic status also, okay, so that is very important, okay, the political status, okay, all these things, okay, it is becomes very important, and that is where, okay, the global education is plays a very important role as well, okay. Cross cultural understanding, yes, okay, again you can see that. So you'd probably realize that your culture is completely different from, okay, the other person's culture, okay. So again, understanding that, okay, understanding, okay, having a perspective on that, okay, is very important. This is naturally why it is important, is unless you have an understanding of these, passing on skills becomes difficult. For example, now, okay, if I do not understand, okay, say the culture of some of you as such, okay, so naturally when I'm interacting with you, I will have a narrow mindset when I am, okay, talking to you. Okay, I will think only from my point of view. I will not be thinking from your point of view. Okay, naturally that leads to a problem. Okay, so global education probably allows us to develop on these things as such. Why adopt a global perspective? Okay, this is what I have been telling as such. Okay, naturally one of the aspects that is important is it takes into account a lot of things. Okay, society, okay, environment, all these things are taken care of. Okay, it takes into account human nature, okay, and person's ability to shape preferences as such. Okay, so that is important. Okay, for example, now when you are looking at somebody who has come from, say, another country like Afghanistan, you would probably realize that culturally they are very progressive as such. Economically, they are not progressive, and because of lack of economic situations, then there is, say, shortage of a number of things that are there, and because of that, probably there is a gap that is there, and communication becomes a little difficult as such. Okay, global perspective also gives us an understanding of opportunities that might be available. Lot of opportunities are there, okay, opportunities for you to learn, opportunities for, okay, you to understand other things, probably, okay, opportunities on how to interact, okay, you will have opportunities to learn about wealth, you will have opportunities to learn about poverty, okay, all these things are there. Okay, of course you learn on, okay, cooperative learning, okay, all these things are possible. Okay, critical thinking, okay, yeah, this is very important. Especially South Indians have, say, critical thinking as part of their, say, DNA. Okay, so they know about everything as such. For example, how Tendulkar should bat, how Virat Kohli should bat, okay, how Modi should take care of this country. Okay, so how, say, the budget should be analyzed, how it should be prepared. So we have, okay, our nose into everything as such. So that is possible. Okay, probably how okay, Trump should say contest the next election. So we have say an opinion on everything that is there. So let us look at probably something which we have to build in our environment for global education. So it is very important as such. So one thing that we have to build is an understanding of the other person. I think I'm repeating this again and again, but it is important as such. So this is a framework. And it becomes especially very important in our university as such, because like I said, we have a lot of say people from other states, we have a lot of people from other countries. So it becomes very important for us to understand them properly, in terms of their culture, in terms of their diversity, in terms of their economic condition, in terms of equality, all these things we will have to understand as such. How to resolve conflict resolution, all these things are very important. Yes. Now these are general things, that is why I am trying to go a little faster in this part as such. So because you know all these things as such, you have been used to that. Probably those of you who are new will get an opportunity and will face these situations, and we will be able to resolve these things as such. Now what can we do? So naturally, so there is an action plan. So we have to add competencies as such. So that is where yesterday's session becomes important. What competencies to learn more, to act more. Learning more is possible with reading, viewing, talking to others, interviewing, talking to experts, all that is possible. And to act more is, for example, if change has to happen, first change has to happen from your side. So your behavior has to change. You have to discuss a lot with others. You have to discuss with like-minded people. So you have to probably put across your point of view. You probably have to look at their point of view. So that is where blogs, letters, articles, all these creative films, dramas, all this become very important for us to interact. And last thing that is possible is, again, donating and so on. I told you one of the factors of global perspective is the economic condition also. That is where donating, fundraising, volunteering becomes part of that as well. The other part is in terms of the teaching learning process in the classroom, in the entire system that we have as such. And I have just put it as points here. If you look at these things, you will understand. One is inclusive classroom. This is one thing which I have been emphasizing on to students as such. For example, now when you get into your house, you have a feeling of belongingness there. You'll probably realize that you have arranged things in your house in such a way that it is according to your preferences as such. Similarly, when a student gets into a classroom, does he have that feeling? You would probably realize a lot of times a student would spend around 6 months in a single classroom. His entire semester would be in a single classroom as well. So that means every day he is coming into that classroom, and he is spending time there, and so on as such. Now, does that classroom have that inclusive environment, which reflects their personality? Probably teachers have to put in across as such. When I think this has been done by the animation department in the classroom that they had, they probably got some paintings done, animated characters done and so on as such. You would realize that when they come to that classroom, they get that belongingness. This is my classroom. So I have to keep it neatly. I have to project it properly. Those things become part of that. Then in the learning process, you have participation for all. So that is important. Student-centered learning, that is what we will be getting into slowly from now onwards with outcome-based education as such. Inquiry-based learning. You have to inculcate this habit of asking questions. So probably that is where you will have to look at alternate methods of teaching, like experiential learning or flipped classroom. All these things have to come in. Cooperative learning, what we normally call as peer teaching, that is important. So where probably you see that you have different levels of students in a class. Everybody is not of the same competency. Everybody is not of the same level. So the students help each other to overcome this assess. So that is important. And that comes with a lot of building of self-esteem. That is important. Now that type of environment has to be nurtured in the classroom by the teacher to a large extent. Today, if you observe your classrooms, you would realize that when you get into the classroom also, you would see a lot of groups that are there. Cultural groups are there. So a group of students from South are sitting in one place. A group of students from North are sitting separate. They don't interact with each other. They look at each other in a very suspicious manner. So all this has to slowly go. You have to develop that self-esteem. So that is where global perspective becomes important. Enabling critical literacy. All these things are important. And of course, studying traditional and contemporary sources are very important. And that is important in every field. In my field also, if you look at programming, if you look at methodologies that we have developed in programming, so we have to understand the older methods, then only we will understand why the new methods have come and what are the improvements, and what is the advantages. And sometimes it might be necessary for us to go back to the older method also. Then only probably we will be able to generate a solution as well. So this is one part of what I wanted to talk. And I had to be a little fast in certain places because of time. I did not want to spend too much for you. Exactly 1 hour we have spent. So I would want to have some interaction as such. So your opinion as such. So do you think a global perspective is important for all of us? Especially for teachers, for students, is it important? Some interaction. I want everybody.
Yes, sir, I do feel like global interaction is very, very much important because education is just not reading out the books. There is a kind of humanness behind it. Not all animals can educate themselves; only human can. And understanding that diversity is very, very much important. And if we do want to know that diversity, understand that diversity and respect that diversity, a globalness is very, very much important. Without that, it could not happen.
So are you trying to tell that now it becomes the responsibility of the teacher to create that environment?
Yes, sir, I do. By any means, it is our responsibility.
Yeah. See, you understand.
Sir, before we hear, I would like to say one thing that education begins from the primary level, right? It's the last stage where we come, and this global understanding of the world should come from the the base. In a university, of course, I agree, completely agree with you that globalness is necessary. I'm sorry. Globalness is necessary, but somehow when I was, I'm just trying to interact in a manner, when I was a kind of encouragement. For example, I am a person who comes from a Bengali medium school, right? When I traveled abroad, I could not even speak English. Seriously, I'm not exaggerating. But British Council and all these agencies, they encouraged me that, okay, fine. Language is not a matter. You can travel and you can experience. This is a physical traveling I'm talking about, not conceptual or otherwise. But somehow in the last few years, it has been decreased, this encouragement. So how we should act is a question.
One of the things that I understand is now it is very important that say our primary and secondary foundation has to be strong, no doubt about that as such. And that is what I said in the beginning. See, today parents give a lot of importance to the type of schools that they want their children to go to and so on like that. Okay? But again, it depends. Okay, for example, see, you are already educated, so you have knowledge related to where your child has to go and so on as such. But somebody who is from a village side, so for him, his child should only go to school, which school and all does not matter so much as such. So there, yes, you would probably realize that he might not get the type of foundation in primary and secondary education. Now, when he comes to higher education, we cannot put the blame on primary education saying that, okay, you did not get good primary education, you did not get good secondary education, so you should not be given the opportunities to overcome that. Okay, so it becomes important for us to understand the situation in the classroom and to support the student as a, somewhere probably when you look at this diagram, this cooperative learning, okay, all these things become important in terms of facilitating the student to overcome those issues and to come to that particular level. Okay, and yes, it is very important. For example, now if you look at my situation itself, I have never been encouraged to for public speaking. Okay. And even in my PG days, when we had to give a compulsory seminar, I would always give an excuse. I would say, today my stomach is paining, today I have a headache, I have this, I have that. Okay. And probably I would be the last person to give the seminar because there was no other opportunity for me to take an excuse. Okay. So that is how I started as such. But me getting involved into teaching slowly made me to overcome this problem. You probably realize today you just call me and say, talk a few things. I think I can spend at least an hour with you talking of all things in this world. So those opportunities has to be given. Some handholding is important. So if we don't do all these things, I think that would be a little difficult. Probably this becomes a little more important when you are, okay, like you said, you come from a Bengali background, okay, or you come from some other country. So I think we have to handhold such students a little more than our normal students. So
sure, that is what we have. Sure, sure.
Any other suggestions? Okay, so let us get technical now. Okay,
sir. Here, yes, I would like to interject.
In
India, the education or educated is synonymous with you knowing English. So Germans do not know English, or for that matter, Japanese don't. Somewhere we are facing this issue where primarily when I look at, other day I was there in a village, okay, some 3 days back. Okay, it was a very remote village, it's called Gulbarga.
Yes, it is, sir. I was there for a few years, sir.
So when I look at the, from an urban and a rural outlook, okay, I feel very sad that they do not have access to the kind of information. Okay, so our head is there in some 22nd century, our tail is somewhere in 18th century. Okay, so when I talk to the some typical 8-year-old or 10-year-old kid, okay, we can see a huge difference in terms of exposure. In the name of Macaulay and this English education, have we left behind this 5,40,000 villages to the remoteness that is going through the, because majorly they are into agriculture. Okay, and for India to succeed going forward, this urbanization has to happen. What is your take on the English and how it has really helped us or hurt this progress?
I am not very sure about the language, sir. I don't want to comment on the language, but of course it has hurt us quite a lot because we have say misplaced our priorities. So if you look at, for example, the Russians, I think they have developed their technology, they have developed everything in terms of their language only. If you look at Chinese, they don't give importance to English. So if you look at the French, they don't give importance to English. But for us Indians, I think the British has left us this say aura as such, where it becomes important for us. We feel that we have educated ourselves if we know that language. Otherwise, it is not proper. Now, that is where, if you just look at what I had said previously, strategy becomes important. For example, now you are taking an animation course as such. Now, there, I think we have to emphasize on this slowly. This change cannot happen suddenly. And maybe I have a feeling that with this new education policy, they have taken care of this situation as such. That is what I have been told as such, but I have not studied the new education policy. I think slowly they have given importance to learning the skill, probably in the local language. I think that change has to happen. And maybe we can contribute slowly as part of that, rather than giving more importance to English as such. I have been trying to do this. For example, now we have this Kannada Sangha as part of our campus. So I have been trying to pump them and push them into us by telling them that you should have more activities. So you should give importance to other people learning this language. Okay? If not for anything else, only for communication at least. So you have a lot of North Indians in Bangalore. You have a lot of people from outside in Bangalore. So when they learn this language, at least somebody will not scold you on the street. And you will not smile at that fellow, okay? So that will not happen. So for that reason, at least you have to say encourage that. So mm-hmm. That is a requirement, but it's a true fact, sir. It is a huge this thing that, and this is probably one of the say factors which probably brings down the esteem of the student. Say somebody, a student who has come from a rural background, his self-esteem is very low because he feels that he is not able to communicate. But I think if we can encourage, I think that will be very good.
May I share a thought? I mean, from yesterday, we are attending this MDP, and one term, which is, of course, not unfamiliar to any of us nowadays, is skill-based education.
Yeah.
This is my skepticism, sir, I'm sharing with all of you, that I somehow believe that private education system, let alone public education system, somehow emphasizing in something, how can I put it? I can call it the production of labor, skilled labor. The reason I'm saying this is that I come from fine arts background. Okay. When art colleges and design colleges were established in colonial India, the basic purpose of that establishment was to produce skilled labor. And artists afterwards fought a lot to liberate themselves from that kind of purpose. Now, again, somehow I feel when I teach, when I interact with students or when I attend meetings, I feel that we are again going back to a kind of neo-colonialism structure where we are just preparing young people for work for a perceived industry, very unstable industry. No one knows how far it will be stable, but we are producing labor. We are not producing citizens, we are not producing humans. This is my skepticism that I thought to share with all of you. I mean,
yes sir. Yeah, I think that is because see, when we are educating students, we do not emphasize on passion. Okay. Mm. So we always emphasize on, say, for example, the need for a good job. Okay. And that is where probably the, say, domain becomes narrow as such. Okay. So, but we are also to certain extent not to be blamed because we do not have the autonomy as such. Okay, so if you, for example, say someone in your field, okay, is say has a passion in fine arts, and you would encourage him into that, and he becomes an expert in that. Probably after he has learned, okay, where should he go? How can he sustain himself? Okay, all these things become, say, probably a question mark as such. So, and I think that can be changed again with the strategy as such. Probably each one of us when we...
What I feel, sir, there's a lack of balance. Of course, when I was studying, you know, for example, I'm studying in art college. My uncle came and asked me that, what will you become? I had no answer. We were passionate about becoming an artist, but this balance is necessary. I do not have something in my hand, a document. It's written by Rabindranath Tagore. In Bengali, it's called Shikhar Bojha. If I translate it, it means the burden of education. It's a very, very beautiful article. If I can find, definitely would like to share with you in future. So this somewhat the balance is lacking. I mean, yes, of course, we need job, but only job, it's getting one-sided. That is, you know, my question. I mean, sometimes I feel very bad when I interact with students and continuously refer to that. You are learning this, you will go to a particular industry. If someone's is learning animation, he or she can imagine himself become an animator, an independent person. Why our education system is becoming a kind of tool for production of human labor?
That
is the only question I'm having.
Now, see, I have a suggestion for you, sir. See, for example, now when I joined this university, I just observed that, for example, even teachers did not have inclination towards research at all. Okay, nobody even thought of that. Okay, their only job was teaching. Okay, and second thing is, even when it comes to students, give them projects. Okay, and say it is all say pre-developed projects. I can say it is not even critical thinking. Those things were not there. So what I did was I started this session for the PG as such. So we call this as knowledge sharing sessions. So where initially we conducted a boot camp, okay, and then where we got experts from outside to say discuss about the types of research that can be done. Okay, all these things are possible. Now, what happened there was every teacher had a mindset where they thought that research is probably not for us. It is a very difficult thing. Okay, we cannot do it. It will not be useful to us. Okay, all these things. It was only when they heard these people and the type of work that can be done and all those things. So things became very simple. And same thing happened with even, say, even publishing a paper. Even for example, say, till I first published the first paper, I always felt that publishing is not for me. I cannot get into this at all. Okay, I am not that intelligent to do all these things and so on. It was only when I put some effort into publishing and then got my first paper published, then I realized that, oh, it can be done by everybody, not by me alone. It can be done by everybody. So I think so somewhere we will have to come out with a strategy. Somewhere we will have to have these sharing sessions, which can happen, okay, with every department. And probably that will give some guidance to the student about the opportunities that are available and the diversification that is available and how they can take it forward. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. I think we will do it. I think we will do it together.
Sir, sorry to interrupt. Actually, just I wanted to share a few things for our previous discussion. Like normally we compare with China, Russia and all, because what happens in China, almost 96% of people are speaking Mandarin. So there is no need for English to take over there. But in India, it is not like that. Every state, we have a different language. Somehow we need some common communication. So that is the reason maybe Indians are giving more importance to English.
Yeah, yeah. And we are very politically motivated also. The moment we say that you have to learn Hindi, people from South will start coming out with their opinions.
But, so, there is one more thing.
People from Bengal will start coming out with their opinion because the politics of Hindi is very, very problematic in independent India. India has many languages. For example, Hindustani, which means our Urdu. Urdu has been killed by Hindi domain. That I will loudly say. It has been killed. Yeah. It has been.
Sir, there is one more thing. Sir, there is one more thing. There is one more thing as far as the English is concerned, sir. This local language or competition between the English and Hindi or any other Bengali or Kannada could happen to certain level up to certain level like 11th, 12th. But when you just get into the nuclear physics, territory of nuclear physics, you won't get a single book that is written in Indian language, either of the book, all or English. So if you
a power of language depends on how much literature is produced.
Yeah, of course. It is there. But at the same time, the spread of the language and the documentizing things, we have learned these things from the British actually.
I would slightly differ on this because I have seen teachers, especially I'm not talking of professors or lecturers and so on, teachers in rural places. For example, when you go to rural part of Karnataka, you'd probably, like sir said, when you go to Gulbarga and so on like that. So there probably you would realize that even teaching in normal English is not possible. Nobody would understand at all. And when you look at, some of the teachers who have there as such, they are exceptional. Okay? They have learned everything in English as such, but the way they convert it and the way they teach in the local language, that is exceptional. So somewhere I think we have to make an effort to encourage that. And not give too much importance to language.
Yes.
Okay. I think we'll slightly stop for some time. Okay. Because we have a lot of things to cover here as such. Okay? I don't want to exceed too much. So I will go through this concept of outcome-based education. Okay. I don't think it would be difficult for me here because you have attended some workshops on this. So I think I can go through a little faster as such. Okay. Now, the concept of outcome-based education was introduced recently, I can say, probably about 25, 30 years back, not before that as such, where a slight deviation from the traditional system happened and little more importance was given to outcomes. Okay. So when we talk of outcomes, it is more student-centric, emphasizing more on the performance of the student and trying to understand what he has learned and what he has not learned and so on. Okay. And probably providing that experience. Now, what we were discussing now as such. So probably providing that experience so that the student can achieve the goals. So that is what is outcome-based education. So that means we are not focusing on just going to a class, taking a topic, finishing that topic and coming, saying that my job is over. Here, when I take the topic to the class, my emphasis would be on whether the student has got that skill. Okay. So outcome-based education concentrates normally on three things. One is on knowledge, one is on skill, and the third one is on attitude. Okay. So these are the three things on which we base the concept of outcome-based education as such. Of course, when you teach the topic, whether he has gained knowledge of those topic is very important. Okay. Whether that knowledge has incorporated an additional skill into the student. Okay. So skill, like we said, like you said, for example, for him to do something independently, as such. And of course, ethics is very important. Attitude is very important. Whether he has developed that attitude or incorporated that attitude, that also becomes important as such. Okay. So we will make a small comparison of the traditional education system and this one. So I will just go a little faster to the next slide as such, which has a table here, which a comparison between a traditional system and outcome-based system. So in traditional system, okay, this what we went through, okay, or rather to say I went through as such. So this is how it used to happen. Learning was passive. So we did not have a semester system. Okay, we had a yearly system. Even my okay, say 10th, 12th, everything was an yearly system. Degree was an yearly system. It was only when I came to my PG, we had this semester system introduced. And in yearly system, okay, we did not have these multiple, what we call as internal assessments and so on. As such, the only thing that was available, that was there for us was a midterm test, a preparatory exam, and a final exam. That's all, nothing else. Okay. And naturally, till midterm comes probably, okay, say 4 or 5 months into the say classes as such. Till then, I would not even bother to find out what are the topics that are covered. Okay, so I would be a passive person in the class. Now that concept has to change. Learners have to become active. So that is important as such. That means you will have to involve the students in terms of whatever you are doing, okay? And like I said, okay, the approach was exam driven, okay? And when it is exam driven, my involvement is not required at all, okay? At least in the early stages of my classes, okay? So even for our degrees as such, say the exams used to be somewhere in the month of March as such, probably till January, I would not even know the syllabus. I don't even know, okay? I would just go to class, okay? Teacher dictates something, I would write down. I had to write a practical record, I would write that, okay? So I would not bother about whether I have really understood or not understood, okay? What are the things, the topics that are to be covered, whether teacher has completed the syllabus, nothing as such. So such, no involvement as such, okay? So it would be naturally in terms of the exams that I'm going to write. Now here it is not like that. That is where, okay, probably if you have listened to our vice chancellor, slowly he wants to increase the internal assessment component as well. So when the internal assessment component increases, now what happens is the involvement of the student becomes more. Okay. So we don't become teachers, we become facilitators, as he calls that. Okay. And traditional system, mugging up was very important. The fellow who could mug the most probably got good marks also as such, and probably was considered as intelligent, immaterial of whether he knew it or whether he did not know it as such. Okay. I can give an example. For example, when I studied my PG, I had a paper called as parallel processing, okay, and parallel processing and image processing as a single paper as such. And in the exam, 4 questions used to be asked from parallel processing and 4 questions from image processing. And out of this 8, we have to answer 5. Now, we very clearly know that, okay, 4 questions, 5 I have to answer, and there's no distribution. It is my choice. Okay. So what I did was very simple thing. Okay. So I just choose among parallel processing and image processing, which was the easiest part. So I concentrated completely on that. So that means 4 questions I have learned. Okay. And one more question, okay, I just had to go through the introductory part of the other part. Okay. So in image processing, I just went through the introductory part. So I got my marks as such. Okay. So if probably out of 80 case, somewhere around 77, 78 marks I have got. Okay. But I don't know anything in image processing. Okay. So my marks card does not tell what I have learned. So a lot of emphasis was only on mugging up things as such. Here it should not be like that. Okay. It should be more on critical thinking, reasoning, reflecting, interaction. Okay. All these things will be encouraged as such. Okay. So syllabus is content based, okay? Syllabus is integrated into learning. That is why if you just look at the TLP that we have provided, you would probably realize that with each module, we have added that component called as assessment, okay? And okay, evaluation there, okay? Assessment and activity, okay? So the reason why we have given there is, okay, so emphasis will be on, okay, what you are learning as such from that particular module and how you will evaluate whether the student has achieved that or not achieved that as such, okay? And okay, learning, okay, you can see was through textbook. Here it is more learner centered, in the sense that the teacher will be the facilitator. Teacher will not be the teacher. You will not come out with a topic and then just come there, teach the topic and go. So you'll probably provide them with pre-material. So they will have to go through that pre-material, and then you will have some sort of interaction that will happen in the class. So the syllabus is rigid and non-negotiable. Okay, here again, okay, so it is more on learning. Okay, here teachers are responsible for learning, and motivation depends on the personality of the teacher. Okay, here learner takes the responsibility, okay, of learning, and the teacher becomes the facilitator and naturally provides the feedback and motivates the students. All those things are happening as such. So that is the difference between traditional and outcome based. Now, outcome based, okay, we are not changing anything drastically as is. Only the approach is slightly different. So that is what we are going to do. Okay. So what does outcome based education address? One, it addresses the skill set. Okay. What is that that the student has to, okay, develop? Okay, not learn, what this that the student has to develop, so which he can apply, okay, somewhere as such. So that skill set is what we are going to concentrate on. To achieve that skill set, how will we facilitate, okay, how will we guide the student to achieve that? Okay, so that is the second thing that we have to, okay, understand with respect to outcome based education. And naturally, when we have put our effort, so we have to assess and evaluate. I think that is what you learned on Saturday, what you call as rubrics as such, the methods of assessment and evaluation. And of course, there is a feedback mechanism that is there. Okay? And that feedback mechanism will basically, it's a self feedback, we can say, which will evaluate what effort you have put. And naturally, in the next semester, you will probably bring in changes so that it improves on the process that you have followed as such. So that is where we have what we call as continuous quality improvement. Okay. So that is something that we will have to follow as such. Some normal things that are there, okay, as such. So William Spady is the person who introduced this, okay, he's a sociologist. Who is called as the father of outcome-based education, which was introduced somewhere around 1994. And of course, it is student-centered, concentrates on clarity, okay, in focus. Okay, that means, okay, every student basically concentrates on how we can develop his skill. Okay, what are the processes that he has to follow? Okay, and what are his weaknesses? What are his strengths? All those things come into play here as such. Based on that, the adjustment has to be made. Okay, as such. So we will have to design, okay, our curriculum. We'll have to design our assessment. We'll have to design, okay, our say facilitation. Okay, all these things has to be done. Facilitation. Okay, all this has to be done based on, okay, the process that we are going to follow as such. And of course, we have to say, when we are facilitating our students, we have to put in a bar which is slightly higher as such. So that means, okay, the student has to achieve that performance, higher level of performance. So don't set your bar at a lower standard. Okay, so when you set your bar at a higher standard, when you support the student in that particular manner, so what happens is naturally the student will exceed that expectation. Okay, and what we were discussing just now, okay, we talk about the expanded opportunities that are possible. That means, okay, you don't say develop your student into a service provider as such. So you can just, okay, help him, support him to learn that he can provide opportunities to other people. So that is possible. Okay. Now, naturally, when we are going through this process, okay, so our student should be employable globally, okay? So naturally, if you give him a BSc animation degree here, tomorrow when he goes abroad, naturally it should be recognized. Otherwise, then there is no meaning as such. Otherwise, what will happen is it will become like our industry as such. Software industry, what happens is our student, 80% of our students are not competent enough for the industry. So the industry picks up the best students, then trains them again separately for a few months, and then only incorporates them into the process. So rather than that, if you say develop standards such that globally it is recognized, then naturally it will be useful assets. That is where we have this Washington Accord. So where standards were developed, especially in the engineering process, and it was the, around 1989, which was it was incorporated as such, and we became a signatory to this in 2014. Okay, so which means that whatever degrees we provide is recognized in all the countries which are part of this Washington Accord as such. So some of the countries which are part of this, like we have Australia, Canada, Taiwan, all these countries are part of the Washington Accord. And based on that, the standards were developed. What are the things that are required in this accord? It is something like this. So we start with the vision statement of the institution and the mission statement of the institution. Okay. Now, this is generated by the university. The university creates the vision and mission statements as such. But we also say, as a department, as a school, should have our mission as such. Mission is nothing but the process through which we achieve our vision. Okay. So if I have a vision that my student should become like this, how to achieve that mission? So what are the things that I will provide to achieve that is the statements that we provide in the mission statement. I will be sharing some of them with you as such. Okay. Then when we come to the course, now here every course is called as a program. So we will, every course will have what we call as a program education objective. Now, a program education objective is an objective that is achieved by that particular course after the student completes that course. Okay, in the sense that somebody has done a BSc in digital filmmaking, somebody has done a BSc in gaming assets. Now, 3 years from that onwards, when you look at what he is doing, is it related to what you have taught him? Okay. If it is related, then we say that you have achieved the educational objectives of that particular course. Okay, so that means after the student has completed the course and moved out as such, and he's applying those knowledge that he has learned. So whether those objectives are met or not, so you'll have to define those objectives as such. Again, I will share some of them. Some examples I will be sharing as such. Okay, and coming to the course itself, so we define some outcomes. So these course should have these outcomes. Now these outcomes have been identified in terms of what we call as graduate attributes. So these graduate attributes has been defined for engineering in the Washington Accord as such. So we pick up those graduate attributes, modify them slightly as such, and then use it accordingly as such. Normally there are 12 graduate attributes which are there. So out of these 12, five are domain specific and seven are non-domain specific, and they relate to a lot of skills that they will be learning as such. It may be life skills, it may be entrepreneurial skills, different skills that they are going to pick up with the course. Okay. And then of course, when we come to the subject that you are teaching, a subject is called as a course, understand? Okay. And the course that you're doing is called as a program. Okay. For example, BSc is a program. Okay. And pre-production design may be a course. Okay. As such. So every course will have an outcome. So we will have to identify those outcomes. And of course, we have some guidelines for that. Those guidelines are defined in terms of what we call as Bloom's taxonomy, where different levels of learning have been prescribed as such. So this will be the key constituents of outcome-based education. And for us, now the job that you have, when you're preparing your TLP, I had a meeting yesterday with all of you as such. So we start from the mission statement, and then we define the program educational objectives and the program outcomes. These things for most of the departments have already been defined, and we'll have to continue with the course outcomes and so on for the subjects that you have defined. Okay, So they are all interdependent, understand that case. So when we look at the course learning outcomes, they lead to certain program objectives, and the program objectives lead to the program educational objectives as such. So they are all interdependent, and each course outcome might say be connected to or might be associated with multiple program outcomes. So it depends. Okay, it is not that every course outcome will be connected to all the program outcomes. That might not be possible. They might be connected to few of them. That is where you will have to have a mapping that will be developed as such. So that is also part of what we have to do. Okay, so vision statement, we will look at each part of the outcome-based education as such. So when it comes to the vision is basically a futuristic statement that the institution department would like to achieve over a long period of time. Okay, the aim. Okay, so this is what I want. Okay, for example, I might have something like create industry ready computer science graduates for the present need of software industry. Okay. This is a general statement. It need not have to be a vision statement. The vision statement is normally for the organization. Understand that. Okay. For us, for example, the vision statement is provided for the university. So we don't have a vision for the department as such. We have the vision of the university, and we have a mission statement also available. But we define another set of mission statement as such. Now this mission statement will basically tell us how to achieve the vision. Okay, for example, it says offer a well-balanced curriculum, and instructions and practical experience to produce skilled graduates with leadership and managerial qualities of modern software industry. Now the statements that we write here, now the mission statement, vision statement will normally be a single statement. Mission statement can be multiple statements also. Okay? So it can be around 1, 2, 3 statements that are there. So if you are splitting it up, then you should have one statement related to knowledge, one statement related to skill, and one statement related to ethics and attitude. So like that, we'll have to define that. Okay. For example, I might provide a mission statement like this. Okay, so to provide high quality professional training with an emphasis on basic principles of computer science and technology. Okay, then to create graduates with moral and ethical values, and enhance interpersonal skill and to have empathy for all forms of life. Okay, so empathy is very important. That means I do not consider anything to be inferior, or I do not consider anything to be superior as such. I give equal importance for everybody. So that empathy should be there. So when I get into a class, this happens a lot of time. You would realize that when you ask questions in a class, you will realize that only a small section of students will always be answering your questions, and you will assume that everybody has learned. No, that should not happen. So that is why when you ask a question and somebody raises their hand, so you should just cross check to see that whether the person has previously answered or not, so that you involve other students also in the process. Okay. And the third one is in terms of skill. Here I've just jumbled up. First one is related to knowledge. Second is related to attitude and ethics. The third one is skill, to empower students with required skills to solve complex technological problems of modern society, and also provide them with a framework for promoting collaborative activities with good managerial skills. Okay. So this might be the mission statement for a particular department. Okay. So like this, you should have, every department should have a mission statement which will tell how we can achieve the vision. So what is required is, first we have to go through our vision statement properly, and based on that we will have to develop the mission statement. Okay, the next thing will be the program educational objectives. The program educational objectives, like I said, basically tells us what your students will be doing after 3 years, after 5 years, with the knowledge that they have gained as such. In other words to say, whether the course that they have done is useful or not. Okay, whether the course that you have offered has achieved those objectives or not. Okay, so that is what we mean by program educational objectives. Normally we provide somewhere between 3 and 5 objectives as such. Okay? For example, the BCA department might have something like this. Okay? Work productively as a computer professional in new age technologies in their career paths and take up supportive and leadership roles in their workspace or to be active in higher studies and research. Okay, that means when you look at your student after 3 years, he should be doing this. Okay, communicate effectively, recognize and incorporate societal needs and constraints and practice their profession with high regard to ethical responsibilities. Okay, so that is important. That means one, he should be able to communicate. That means to interact with each other, to probably resolve issues that are there, to maintain peace. So those things are important, and to have constraint in terms of his behavior, and follow ethical practices. I should not cheat. Okay. For example, I get into a train, I should buy a ticket. I should not get in without buying a ticket. So those types of mentality should not be there. Okay. And the last thing will be engage in lifelong learning and to remain current in their profession to foster personal and organizational growth. So this will be a set of program educational objectives which every course should have. Okay, so one team has to develop this asset. Okay. Then comes the program outcomes. That means whatever course you are offering has some outcomes. These outcomes have been divided into two parts as such, and they are based on the graduate attributes which have been defined in the Washington Accord. So 12 graduate attributes have been defined. Okay, 5 of them are domain specific. The first 5 are domain specific. So for example, I am relating this to computer science. Okay, so you will have to modify this slightly. Okay. In terms of your courses as slightly, very slightly as such. Okay? So computational knowledge, problem analysis, develop solutions, conduct investigation of complex computing problems, use modern tools and techniques. Okay? So these are 5 domain specifics that are there. And non-domain specific, which incorporate life skills, ethical values, lifelong learning, entrepreneurial skills. Okay? So these things are related to the remaining 7 that are there: professional ethics, lifelong learning, communication efficacy, societal and environmental concerns, individual and teamwork, innovation and entrepreneurship, project management and finance. So these are the complete set of skills which a student will learn by the time he has completed your course. This is a complete set of skills. Now this program outcomes have already been developed. All we would want you is to go through them once. Okay, just go through them once and try to check out whether any changes are required, anything can be added, anything should be corrected, grammatical mistakes, all those things as such. For example, for the computer science courses, we have the 5 domain specific which have been defined like this. Similarly, I think your coordinators will have the program outcomes. Okay, you can just have a look into that. And the remaining 7 non-domain specific are here. Okay. So I have 4 of them here and 3 of them in the next slide. Okay, professional ethics, lifelong learning. Yes. Anybody wants to, or any queries you have related to this much? First, let me answer before I go to the other things.
So, we do not have a separate school as far as media and media-based programs are concerned.
No, separate school is not there, sir.
We fall under the bracket of computer science.
Computer science as of now. Okay, so
how much essence we have to maintain where it would not have any conflict going forward in terms of PEOs or...
We will have to be very close to the attributes. So now, for example, if you can remove this word computational and add something related to your domain. Okay.
Because tomorrow's audit also happens. It should be authentic. Okay.
Somebody should
come and say, even though it comes under the computer science, it is a separate stream in itself. So you should have its own attribute.
Yeah, it will have its own attribute, but like I said, the attributes cannot change drastically. Okay, so find domain specific attribute which are close to these these attributes are important. For example, if you talk of computational knowledge, so specific to animation, what is the knowledge that is required? Probably you can say storytelling knowledge, okay, or something like that.
We have a three pillar centric approach where storytelling, technology and design we incorporate.
You have to incorporate
sync with the, even from the computer science background, how do you have to produce?
No, sir.
So you not have there, to... technology component is there. Maybe the storytelling part is not there because you don't get into the business aspect.
Correct, sir. That is
so, yes, so there will be some dialogues happening on this front.
We will always probably come out with a solution or take a middle ground when such it.
Second query would be on the assessment. The computer science has been assessed in a particular way. So those assessment pattern has to be absolutely replicated for us, sir?
No, not required at all, sir. Only the division we'll have to uphold. That is, for example, when we have the 30-70 pattern, that has to be held as such. But how you will incorporate your 30 is left to you.
Okay, sir. Right. Please. Thank you.
And oh, even sir, in the attributes, you'd realize that the last seven are, non-domain specific. So naturally, they will remain the same. And even in the domain specific, I think some of them, for example, develop solutions will be there. Usage of modern tools and techniques will be there. Okay, probably the only few of them will probably require some, restructuring.
Yeah, because we did this exercise some 6 years before with one of our partners. Okay. There are certain rigid systems because they were coming from engineering background. Okay.
No.
It was really funny because whether you like it or not, we had to
follow that.
Yeah. Okay, right, please.
Sir, Nachappa sir.
Yes.
Sir. I have a small submission to you.
Yes,
I mean, for last a few days, I have been attending many sessions. Faculty development and others, also our vice chancellor session. What I feel that the lack of emphasis on art education, as long as Jain has an art department, design department, like animation, VFX, or whatever, art education is a very new thing in India. Yeah. I mean, I used to work as a teacher, school teacher. Long back in 2007, 2008, that time, art education, the concept was not there. If we have one session on art education, especially in the field of design, how art and technology related to each other. So this is just a submission. This is not even a question. If we have one session on this subject, would be very helpful because whatever you say, program outcome, learning outcome, fine. But somewhere, art education is very, very different from engineering, management, business studies, or any other kind of disciplines. It's a multidisciplinary.
Yeah.
But art, no one talks about art. Everyone takes it for granted. They're okay, fine. We will.
No, sir. Actually, in our university, so we have a school of design.
Mm.
Okay, but that is more related to traditional design as such. It is more for example, if you have an industrial problem, okay, how to develop a design solution for that. So they concentrate on that. But now, if you look at the structuring that has happened, emphasis will be on departments. Okay, so now you have, okay, for example, an animation department. Okay, so the functionality will be identified, okay, and highlighted from the department level. So what I am now describing here, for example, in terms of POs, is basically in terms of how you are you will have to project yourself. Okay, for example, when you are defining your program outcome, I'm just giving you a guiding line. That's all. Okay, It is, I'm not telling that you will have to exactly follow these words only. Okay. So you will have to understand your department. You will have to understand the strengths of your department, and correspondingly, you will have to make those modifications that are required. Okay. Especially when you are defining your program, educational objectives, your so you can everywhere identify. That is why we want you to start from the mission statement. Okay. So the guidelines that I'm giving for the mission statement is one statement related to knowledge, one statement related to ethics and attitude, one statement related to skill. Okay. I am not telling that you have to use this statement, that statement as such. You know, you are the expert. Okay. So you know specifically if it is related to knowledge, how I have to describe that.
Sure, sir.
So you have to take that responsibility. So similarly, program educational objectives. Okay. So if you look at your students after 3 years, okay. So, and take a feedback from him. And try to understand whether what you have taught him has been useful or not. And if you want to measure that, that is where your program educational objectives will come into things. So there, again, one sentence will be in terms of the work that he is doing as such, whether he's applying what he has learned, whether he's providing the type of leadership that is required, or whether he's continued into higher education or something like that. Something he has to be doing after 3 years. So that you will have to describe in your program educational objectives. You don't have to copy and paste what I have told you. And similarly, the graduate attributes, few conditions are there. The first condition is 12 graduate attributes. That is compulsory. And first 5 should be domain specific. Remaining should be non-domain specific. Good. The first 5 are related to these things. You modify them accordingly, and then you give the program outcomes. So that is how we will have to go about.
Thank you.
I'm just providing you with some examples so that you are not into a terrain which is unknown as such. So you have something at least as a guiding light for you. Okay. Now specifically, if you have a course, for example, specialization, then you'll have to have something called as program specific outcomes. This might not be responsible for, a requirement for you, but we had this as a requirement for BCA and MCA, because in BCA we have different specializations. But now under BSc Animation, you don't have. So if you have specialization, for each specialization, you might have to identify program specific outcomes. Again, there also the first statement will be related to analytical thinking. Second one will be in terms of usage of technology, and third one will be in terms of ethics. So that will be there. Otherwise, it is not required. Now, related to the subject that you are teaching, every subject will have course outcomes. And these course outcomes, you will have to, this is what you are going to do now as such in terms of the teaching, learning and evaluation process that you have started. So you will have to define about 5 statements for each subject. Those 5 statements, we call them as course outcomes. And you will have to follow Bloom's taxonomy here. Bloom's taxonomy, Benjamin Bloom in 1956 introduced this as such to promote, a process in education. He divided it into 3 domains, what we call as cognitive, affective, and psychometry as such, based on, the various things a human being has to learn. One is mental skills, another is in terms of emotional skills, and the third one in terms of physical skills as such. For us, we concentrate a lot on cognitive skills as such, and it has been modified. Benjamin's taxonomy has been modified, and it basically has different levels. So the lowest level of cognitive skill that a student develops is in terms of knowledge, then slowly comprehension gets added to that, then application skills gets added to that, analytical skills, analysis skill gets added, synthesizing, and finally evaluation. Now you will have to say your syllabus that you are providing should fall into this classification, and as much as possible it should slightly be on the higher level, because when you go at the lower level is more in terms of just understanding. Okay, so recalling information. Okay, and this was what we were doing all the time till now. Okay, mugging up things and reproducing it. So we'll have to go into slightly better skills that are there. Okay, and how outcome based education implements this?
Yes. This analysis, evaluate, and create. So these are the three we operate in the highest.
Yes, sir. I have provided a table also, sir. Okay.
Yeah. So for us, it is more from the creation perspective because we will be into higher order thinking.
Okay. Creation cannot come directly, sir. Okay.
No. The highest pyramid.
Yeah.
Evaluation, what has been put across, we actually use it for create.
Okay. Yeah.
Analyze, evaluate, and create. We have. Okay. So more emphasis both from PG and UG perspective, we give on the create. When a student creates a project, okay, be it an asset or a...
Sir, that is correct. So that will be in terms of, say, for example, when he has completed the subject, then you can say that the outcome of that will be that he should be able to create this or create that and so on like that. But in the process of completing, for example, when you have taught him module one in the subject, okay, so what is the outcome of that module? Okay, naturally, the first module that you're teaching might be something related to the introductory concepts of a certain domain. And the outcome of that, he may not be able to create the final product as such. So that means each, say, module probably might be at different levels in Bloom's taxonomy. Overall, when we look at the objective, then it might be he should be able to create something as such. So
that when we look at how we have bifurcated is, it is all from the apply perspective, whatever we are being taught.
Okay, yes, sir. Yes.
Application.
Okay. Yes, sir. Analysis, application, creation. That will be the higher levels
of. Start with the level three to begin with. So they start applying. Okay. That's what the assignments are all about. And yes, when they do their independent project, it goes to the creation level.
Yes, sir. That will what say we this also. What,
when I say talk about improvisation, this is what we would be applying going forward because to conform to your university requirements.
100%, sir. 100%. Okay, so we and that is what the university expects also. So when we have say higher levels of Bloom's being described, the university will be very happy that courses like animation, digital film making, and this one are able to achieve those levels when compared to say others. This thing as such. Okay.
Yes. Thank you.
I've just put in some now roles as teachers. For us to go through as such. So one is naturally review our POs, POs, courses, syllabi, okay? Then teach the relevant concepts here, okay? Even though I have used the word engineering, maths, and other relevant concepts as such. Then additionally conduct tutorials and laboratory and practical session, okay? So in this entire system, this will be our role, okay? Give appropriate guidelines for assignments and projects. This is where rubrics becomes important. Okay, this is what the vice chancellor emphasized on recently as such. So what happens is we give them an assignment and we evaluate the assignment. So when the student is preparing the assignment, he has no idea of what is expected. And even when the marks comes, he has no idea why he has got that marks. Okay, so to overcome that issue, so rubrics becomes important. So we give an empirical, and finally we have to map the POs and COs that we have done. Okay, of course the required documentation in terms of accreditation has to be prepared, and of course continuous quality improvement process. Okay, we will inform. And students also have some roles in this system. So it is not that he just comes there and sits there. He also should know what are the outcomes of the program, what are the objectives of the courses, okay? What are the outcomes of each module that he is learning, how his say assignment will be evaluated, what are the rubrics, okay, all these things he has to involve himself in. And slowly we will be providing probably sessions to students also, so that they will be able to understand this, okay. And we will have to slowly, over a period of time, it might not happen. So we will slowly have to move from being teachers to facilitators as such. So this is what I wanted to cover as such. So yeah, before I conclude, if you have some queries or any discussions, your opinions, or a general question, have I been useful?
Yes, sir. It's very useful for us, and because.
But have I successfully put you to sleep?
Not at all, sir.
No, sir.
I remember. Yeah, when I was studying my class 12, so we had this zoology paper. We had a teacher who was very passionate about explaining. And by mistake, if you ask a question to him, he would take around 30-40 minutes to give the explanation. And invariably, by the time he has completed, all of us would be sleeping. Okay. So I still have my notebook on which I have written Book of Hypnosis. So I hope I have not done the same thing to you.
No, sir. Really interesting. And right now, I think we got a very clear picture about what is that outcome-based learning. And yes. Everything we got now very clear.
So I'm always available, as you know. Okay, so as you start the process, okay, yesterday we have informed that team should be formed and we should start going through the process as such. So my purpose today was to give you a different perspective of this thing, a small understanding of higher education, a small understanding of higher education in India, and how global perspective was important, and probably small insight into outcome-based education. I have not been able to touch assessment. Okay? I had been into a workshop long back on outcome-based education. And if I have to thoroughly cover each and every aspect of that, so we would require at least around 5 hours of interaction. So if you really feel that somewhere you want thorough knowledge, I am available, no doubt about that. Okay. So,
but the recording of what the VC took the other day. VC sir had a presentation on
that. He said he will share the. They
are going to share, sir. Very soon they are going to share.
Yeah, he will be sharing the PPT with us, sir.
Because we have a lot of interpretations based on how this OB has to be implemented. If VC has a certain vision, the way it has to be implemented, we'd rather comply with that.
Yeah, he is more into
the session. It would be important for all of us.
Yeah.
To follow the norm.
So I have the recording. I had done a screen capture of it. So sure. I have the recording of both the days, sir. I will share it with you, sir, on an email.
Please,
you, right now I can share it. Otherwise, VC sir has already said that they will be sharing it with us. So maybe a more refined version can come from there.
Okay. No, when the refined version comes, well and good. But please share it to all the team members here.
Sure, sir.
Because going forward, in the upcoming 2 or 3 months, this becomes very critical for us, all of us to be on the same page.
Sure, so, sir.
Sooner the better.
Right. Yeah. Sure, sir. Sure.
You are exactly right, sir. What the purpose of this FDP again is to ignite that passion, okay, and the importance. So it is very important that probably I have just given you some insight to this. So you will have to have a thorough knowledge of each of the things as such, especially related to outcome-based education. So that is why if possible, you can go into the UGC website and some documents are available. So you can just download and the small documents. I think outcome-based education, it's just around 40 pages. So if you just go through that, it will be good. And assessment, I saw a document which was around 24 pages. So I will try to download and share it with you. So if you just go through that, I think probably you will also get a thorough insight of all these things. Okay. So thank you very much. Okay. So I'm very happy that I've been part of this. Okay. I thank Dinesh sir for giving me this opportunity to interact with you. And I can just wish you all the best. Please take care. Okay. So vaccine is coming.
Thank you, sir. On behalf of the entire family of the iNurture team and on behalf of all my faculties at Jain University for the animation vertical, I thank you very much for your time and for this wonderful session. It's been both informative. Yes, it's been very informative, especially it was an entire recap of the OBE of what PC sir said. So it was very useful for us. Definitely, and you definitely didn't put us to sleep. So yes, I'm sure you must have noticed that with all the other faculties who were interacting with you, and they had so many things that they wanted to still talk about. So it's been interactive also. So thank you very much, sir, for your support. Thank you, Dinesh, sir, for once again for having Nachappa sir with us today.
Thank you, Nachappa sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
It's a privilege just because when we conduct such training workshops, we want active participation, okay, where we find a purpose, okay. Yes. Most of time, yes, we get a lot of bells and whistles, but at the end of it, when we look at what we, what is there for the take, okay, today we had a lot of take in this, okay. So really, thank you for the wonderful session, okay. Right from the macro level to the micro level, you dealt. Okay, so you covered the ecosystem of education. Okay, how many universities, how many people are pursuing. So most of this was a very, very valuable information. And many of the my faculty team members, my team, okay, whether they pursue the career with us or go forward wherever they want to go. Okay, this OBE would be there in a dark way, following the footsteps, okay? Because when we started this journey some 5-6 years before, there were certain universities which had started implementing. They're wondering where it is leading to. But now we see almost many, many universities, okay, to adhere to the norms, they are following. So it is very important for all of us to understand, okay, over and above that OBE is there to stay for a long time to come, because now, with the advent of, say, BEED, all these YouTubes, the information is available on the run. So all the more important why the student has to come to a classroom to acquire or experience what we call as experiential learning. So in this regard, I once again thank you very, very much, sir, for this wonderful session. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, all faculties. I will be sharing a feedback form with you. Kindly fill that up. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.